So in this concept, we are discussing about the deep performance tuning in ABAP. So in this, we'll be discussing about the outline of outlining the SAP NetWeaver application server ABAP architecture. So we have outlining the NetWeaver application server ABAP architecture. So we have this. This is how the server actually works. In this particular client server architecture, if you see, we have the database process, we have the application process. Then you know, in the latest version, we'll have the internet in between the presentation process and the application process. Previously, we used to directly access the system from the two-tier architecture. In the two-tier architecture, we used to access the data directly from here. Three-tier architecture also, we used to access the data directly. But then when we have the multi-tier, when we have the browser. So from the browser, when we are accessing everything from the browser, we have the internet in the middle. So this is what we have. This is the architecture of the modern data technology. So if you see this, the instance of an SAP system, we have the database, we have the application tag, and we have the presentation tag. As we observed that, you know, application tag has been narrowed down in the latest HANA database, but you know, in this is the architecture that we have in prior to the HANA database, wherein like application level used to play a major role in the entire process. So then we have the NetWeaver application server above up to version 7.0. After the 7.0 version, we have a different process. As we discussed, you know, that will be there in the HANA platform. So we have ABAP can be installed on different hosts to the central instance. So we have ABAP central instance, we have ABAP instances in the scalability. So what exactly happens is other instances on additional hosts, several instances for each host are also possible. So each host will have a different process. What I mean to say is like, we'll have one host. In each host, in a, every single host, we'll have the entire ABAP central instance. In that ABAP central instance, again, we'll have the dispatcher, we'll have the work processes, and all these things will be normally then in each and every host. And there can be multiple hosts. So if you have this host, we have this ABAP application server. Then we have the scalability. So we can increase the number of hosts. For the kind of performance, to increase the performance, we have message server and we have NQ server in the ABAP system central services. So message server actually gives an input of status of what exactly is the performance of that, and NQ will always be updating the activities. So the database can be installed on a different host from the application server. So here, as we discussed earlier, we used to have the data. If our select statement is going and hitting the database interface and then local buffer, then that is how OpenSQL OpenSQL commands work. In ABAP, native SQL statements and OpenSQL statements are the two statements that we have, which we already discussed in the past. So native SQL statements directly go and retrieve the data from the database, whereas the OpenSQL statements first check the database interface, and from the database interface it goes and checks the local buffers. If the data is there in the local buffers, the system will get it. If it doesn't have, then it'll automatically convert that into the native SQL statements, and then we'll get the data into the database state. This is what we have. So we have application server ABAP process. In the application server ABAP process, we have ABAP message server, then we have the gateway, the internet communication manager. So we have ABAP dispatcher. So this all is the application server ABAP process. So these all are the parts of application server. So what exactly the message server does? Message server makes sure that all the data is displayed, and the gateway will actually connect the front end to the back end. An internet communication manager will actually enable us to get the connectivity between the web and the database. We have a dialog system, we have background, we have log management, we have spool, and we have update process. So this is the SM50 transaction where all work processes of an instance can be seen. So you just need to make a note of this transaction code SM50. Later I'll be asking you the transaction code for work processes of all the work process instance. How to check the work process instance? We can go to SM50 transaction. In SM51 transaction, we can see all the instances of an SAP system. So there we have seen the work processes. Here we have seen the instances. So how many instances, how many have been logged in. Then we have the SM66 transaction wherein we can see all active work processes of a system. All active work processes can be seen in SM66 transaction. And then we have the dialog work process multiplexing. So this is something which actually what happens is there will be two kinds of memories, guys, ABAP memory and the SAP memory. ABAP memory will actually hold all the, see, for example, you have to save the internal table. Internal table data is saved in the ABAP memory, wherein like the process, with the work process, like, you know, from PAI to PBU, if you want to convert the data, if you want to change the data and all these things, from one screen to another screen, if the data has to move, it will first go to the SAP memory and then come back to this. This is called the instance memory in this case. So instance memory is something where we have the user context. So we get this data from one screen and pass it to another screen using the user context. So this is called the dialog work process multiplexing. So in the work process in detail, we have database library, we have database interface and SAP work process. We have task handler, we have database interface, we have the DynPro processor and we have ABAP processor. So DynPro processor, ABAP processor, then we have the database interface. So dialog work processor in detail are any task handler will have these three things. A task handler will be holding these things, database interface, DynPro processor and process ABAP processor. Okay, so database interface connects to the database and then it will get the data. So whenever we write a ABAP code, that automatically will convert into SQL code in the database level and then it will be executed there. So we have work processes and transaction update. So when we have this work process, each work process will do one task and the database access is done by multiple work processes. Okay, so what we just discussed is the architecture of SAP NetWeaver application server, ABAP, and describe the role of work processes in SAP NetWeaver. Then we have the memory management. So we have seen a couple of transactions which we are going to see in the real-time system and explore them. You can just go through this and this document is there with you all as well. Already I have shared it with you all. So this is like identifying the memory areas used in the SAP systems. So we have user context in the SAP systems and memory areas in the SAP systems. So in memory areas, there will be multiple memory areas, guys. Like there will be SAP memory and there will be ABAP memory, as I told you. Okay. So in this, we will discuss more in detail about the user context in SAP instance. We have session context and we have session context one, session context two. So we basically have this RAM. How much is the RAM being consumed? Okay. How much is the RAM being consumed for a particular process? Or the entire system, how much is the RAM consumed? How much is the page file swap file? Okay, page file and swap file. How much is the consumption of the virtual memory? So there will be RAM. RAM will be actually RAM is equal to this page file swap. So for this, how much is the memory that is being taken? Okay, consumed can be seen in ST06 transaction. So this is called operating system virtual memory. You will need to make a note of this one also, ST06. For just checking the server performance. Okay. Then we have the all processes of one instance. So we have shared memory and we have a virtual memory. So in the entire memory, virtual memory, we'll have local memory and we'll have shared memory. So the work process will actually consume the shared memory. It will make use of the shared memory, but each work process have its local memory and there will be a common memory called shared memory from which we can pass the information from one work process to another work process. So we have the virtual memory, we have the work process, each work process has a local memory and we have a shared memory. This is the same thing which we are discussing it here. The same thing we are discussing here. Okay, so now here we have this extended memory. In shared memory, we'll have something called extended memory. In shared memory, again, we'll have extended memory. Now here we have SAP heap memory. So SAP heap memory will be in the local memory. So then we have this. Okay, we can go to ST02 transaction and check the page area, extended memory, and heap memory. So how much memory is done? So you need to make note of all these transaction codes and explore them and see all these things. How much memory, extended memory has been consumed? How much is the heap memory? How much is the page memory? Page area memory. So all these things we can just check that. And we have something called SAP buffer. SAP shared memory, and we have SAP buffer. SAP buffer will also be there in the shared memory only, and SAP extended memory also will be in shared memory only. So in this, like buffer, we can see in the ST02. We can go to the buffers available in the transaction for ST02. Then we have this shared extended memory. Also, we can check that in the ST02 transaction. So we have the page file. So paging buffer. There will be something. We have seen extended buffer. We have seen buffer, and then we have the paging buffer. Paging buffer will actually get connected to the SAP page file. So these are the three buffers which we'll be having in the shared memory, guys. So shared memory, SAP buffer, SAP extended memory, and SAP paging buffer. So all these are there in the shared memory. All these are virtual memories. Okay. So local memory, we have local memory for each work process, and then again we have the SAP heap memory. So all this SAP virtual memory can be seen in the same transaction code as we have seen above. So ST05. Okay. So that's something which we have, which I have seen, and we can analyze what exactly is happening. So how much is the time consumed, or what is the memory consumed? So if it is taking too much of memory, we can reduce that. So all these things can be done in the backend. So most of the transactions which are starting with SM and ST are system management and system system transactions. So those things can be managed. Those are basically managed by the network and administration people, guys. So but we should be knowing it. So let's understand this memory allocation sequence in a dialog memory process. So let's say each one of us is accessing some memory. So data for user, let's consider the data for SAP user 4. So we'll have a dialog work process. Okay, first a defined initial part of the ABAP extended memory is used in rolling. So rolling is like, this person is using a certain amount of memory, SAP extended memory, a shared memory. So now what happens here is this mapping. The mapping will be done like this. Okay. So in this, like, we have defined initial part of the SAP extended memory is used in rolling. So what exactly happens here is first a defined initial part of the SAP extended memory is used. Okay, that is called rolling. Okay, so the initial part of the SAP extended memory is used, and that is called rolling. And then we have a defined initial part of the SAP extended memory, which is like, for example, this one. Okay, this particular, these things have been used for the SAP user 4. Now here we'll have something called role area. The extended memory has been used by the user, right? The SAP user 4, and we have role area. Role area actually gets connected to this particular thing. So whatever is been assigned, the rolling memory that has been assigned, it will be using that. And then we have this, then we'll be having this, it will be connecting to this. So here we have the page area. Page area is something which will hold the page of the user. Okay, page area actually holds the user's page, but role area will actually hold the data which is being presented on the screen. Okay, so SAP extended memory, in SAP extended memory will have this. Then here you cannot access something, a page area, the extended memory which has been already been allocated to some other user. Okay, so SAP extended memory, in this the memory that is being used here by user 4 are able to access something, but if it is something which is already consumed by used by other user that cannot be accessed. So until the maximum allowed size for a context is reached. So even if you if it's a maximum how much a person a user can access or how much memory a user can use, there will be a limit. More than that limit, you will not be able to use. That is again another criteria. So then the system, if it is if he is trying to use more than the memory allocated to a particular user, then the system is forced to use the private part of the private memory, and that's called SAP heap memory on the operating system local memory. So we'll have a SAP heap memory. So SAP he will be then allocated to the SAP heap memory more than what is allocated. If he is trying to use that, then you know he has to take care of, he has to go ahead and consume the heap memory. Okay, so let's say if there is an SAP a second user, okay, user 2 cannot access the local memory of the user 4. Okay, so that heap memory and the page memory, whatever you have used, all these things, whether it might be the role area, paging area, all these things which are there saved for a particular user, cannot be, this mapping is also done. So that cannot be used by another person. So in private mode. Okay, if this is a private mode, if the user is in private mode, if he is consuming in private mode, then it cannot be used by other users. Okay, so if this is like, you know, this is again a private mode wherein we have dialog work process. If SAP heap memory is in use, further steps of current transaction of this user won't be dispatched to other dialog work process. So even if he wants to share something to others, the because they are using the private memory, they cannot be giving the access to that one from other users to the other users. Okay, so here we have the analyzing the current memory usage of an instance that can be done in the same transaction which we have seen previously, ST05. So ST02, we'll be seeing this ST02. So in ST02 we can see the current memory analysis. So we need to go and check this transaction, guys. So ST02 is something which we need to go and check the transaction. We have virtual memory. We have SAP heap memory and we have a virtual memory. And SAP virtual memory is in the RAM page file. So we have extended memory up to setTTA slash role underscore extension. So memory allocation sequence for the dialog work process types. So we have shared memory and we have a private memory. First every user will be using the shared memory. So and then we have this, you know, dialog work process. For dialog work process we have extended memory up to an extension, and we have heap memory up to a particular exhausted when it is exhausted. So non-dialog work processes, we have this SAP heap memory up to ABAP heap area non-dimensional. So we'll discuss about that. So basically describing the memory allocation during the ABAP process is what we've discussed. So analyze the memory allocation to an SAP instance, describe additional topics in the memory allocation. So in this, well, let me once consolidate, guys. So what we discussed is there will be for every user there will be a dialog work process. For every user there will be dialog work process. This dialog work process can in turn access the extended memory, and that is called role in. Now in the role area whatever we have here, role area, we have data can be accessed to up to a certain limit, and after that you will not be able to access this particular data. Okay. Then we have the SAP data for user, SAP user 4. So we have private area. So if it's a private area, okay, private area, when it will be consumed, when the memory has been obsolete. Okay, so if he has used enough amount of memory in the extended memory, then they will be he'll be allocated the private memory. Private memory cannot be accessed by other users, as simple as that. And we can go into ST02 transaction and check how much is the current memory for a particular user. For each user we can go and check how much is the memory allocated. So if we go to ST02, we can see who is consuming most amount of memory. Then we can end that transaction so that, like, you know, the performance will be increased again. Then we'll be defining the architecture of a work process. So we have in the work process, what will happen is we have a SAP memory, guys. This is a common memory. Then we have external mode. We'll have the external mode here. Now, let's say we are just passing parameters using SAP memory. Now here we have SAP memory and we have ABAP memory. As I told you, we have SAP memory and we have ABAP memory. So SAP memory, if one screen you have entered some data and then that data has to be passed to another screen, then it has to pass the parameters. It has to pass these fields from one system to one screen to another screen. Now there will be external mode and we'll have ABAP memory. We'll have extended mode and we'll have ABAP memory. So we have internal mode in details. So we have internal mode and we have ABAP memory. So here we have external mode. External mode is something which is out of which is common. In the external mode, we'll have two things: ABAP memory and internal mode. So in internal mode, again we'll have the PXA and rolling area. This is a rolling area. Now in the rolling area, we have the local data. So each word process will again have a local data, right? So we have then runtime objects. So runtime objects, let's say runtime objects of screen 100, screen 101, 102. So each one will have its own runtime objects and all will have their local data, and all local data is being linked to rolling area. And then we have ABAP memory here. So the internal mode, the call sequence, submit and call transaction, all these things. So these operations, submit, program and return, so all these things will be running on the internal memory. So that is a part of external mode. So we have this ABAP memory. We have an ABAP memory. We have an ABAP memory. And we have internal session 1 and session 2. So internal sessions will use, the program will use ABAP memory, guys. Remember this. So the work area, internal table, whatever we are storing the data and all, that will be in the work, in the ABAP memory. Remember that. So we are storing the data in internal table, we are storing the data in work area. Those all will be stored in ABAP memory. And from screen to screen, if you want to move the data, that has to be passed to the SAP memory. So now the internal mode or internal mode active and internal mode. So if internal mode active cannot access it. So we need to make everything active, only then it can access it from one screen to another screen. Okay. And we have submit program or leave to transaction and call functions. All these will be working only when we have the active mode. So we can go to ST02 and analyze the external and internal modes. We can also check the external and internal modes in the ST02 transaction. So I've just defined the architecture of work processes. Analyzing the memory consumption using the ABAP debugger. So ABAP debugging is a very important concept, guys. Whenever, especially when you are working on the support project, the work in your support or testing project or support project or maintenance project, in which the work will first start with debugging, because mostly what kind of work you will get is some issues have raised, something is not working, then you have to fix it up. So for fixing up, you have to first analyze. So for analyzing, we need to open the debugging and see what is happening in the backend in the program. So for that, debugging is extremely important. So we'll analyze the memory consumption using the ABAP debugger. See, when we see that some program is not working, this is how we actually proceed. How much memory has been consumed for that? If let's say the user is giving this much input, so is it consuming more time in the ABAP memory? Is it consuming more time in the more load on the external memory? External memory in the sense like external memory will have a part of ABAP memory or internal memory. So internal memory in the means SAP memory. So is it taking more time in the SAP memory or is it taking more time in the ABAP memory? Is it taking more memory, more of the RAM? It is consuming more of the RAM in internal memory or in the ABAP memory? Everything we can check there. Okay, in the transaction, we can go to ST02 transaction and check it. So introduction, scope and purpose of the memory in the application server is a valuable resource with significant impact on single user performance and system scalability. Memory leaks that continually increase an application's memory consumption must be eliminated. Okay, and memory consumption must be minimized and may at most depend linearly on the amount of processed the data. So what we are discussing is we need to reduce the burden on the application server, guys. So we should not consume data which is not required. Okay, we have to avoid that. So how the transaction patterns will be. So if we understand the transaction patterns, then if let's say we have the individual online transaction, that is a short-lived internal modes. So we have memory leaks have little effect. All memory is freed when an internal mode is deleted. So these all will be a part of internal memory. Internal means everything will be taken care by the work process, single work process. But when we have present, we have work center like UIs, that is long-lived internal modes. Memory leaks will accumulate as the internal mode will not be deleted. So what we are trying to discuss here is, like, let's say here this has been accessing in internally in SAP login. But when we log in from the web page, okay, web page, and sometimes you have to leave it there. We have to, you know, maintain the data in the memory for a long time. Then we'll always go for multiple work processes so that the load is decreased on the entire process. Because if let's say we are getting once we get the output, we are coming out of the program or coming out of the transaction, it'll be freed up. But when you have to maintain the same screen for a longer time and you want to shuffle from one screen to another screen and you want to play around with the data for a long time, then it's better to maintain that in the better to manage it from different work processes here. So in this, work package is been implemented. Instead of this work package, in the sense, we'll be having each work process will be processing one particular task. So what are the terminologies that we use in the memory allocation? We have bound memory will be freed if the dynamic memory object is deleted. Referenced memory, maximum that may be freed if the dynamic memory object is deleted. Object size, memory used by the object directly. Allocated memory, memory allocated by the system. Used memory, memory used for the application. So object size should always be less than or equal to bound memory. Bound memory should always be less than or equal to referenced memory. Reference memory should always be less than or equal to used memory. And used memory should always be less than or equal to allocated memory. Because allocated memory is the biggest one in which we are going to have used memory. If used memory can never be greater than the allocated memory, right? So this is how it is. So we have bound memory will be freed if the dynamic memory object is deleted. So let's say, for example, bound memory can be freed when we delete the internal tape. Reference memory, maximum that may be freed in the dynamic memory object is deleted. So reference memory. So reference memory is, for example, the pointers use the reference memory. We have declared and discussed about the pointers concept. So object size, memory used by the object directly. Allocated memory, memory allocated by the system. Used memory, memory used for application data. So we have this debugger tool, variable fast display, memory analysis. This is the analysis, I'll be explaining you that. Debugger tool memory analysis. We'll do it in the ST02 transaction. So analyzing the ABAP reports at design time. So now we have this code inspector. So code inspector is very important. We have performance, security, and syntax. All these three will be checking in code inspector. So code inspector, how do we open the code inspector? Is when we open the program, we'll have this check. And in this code inspector will be there. So when you click on the code inspector here, in the check, we have used extended program check. So now here we have code inspector. So we can go into the code inspector and click on that. So here in this instance, we are actually checking the code inspector for the interface. We have created an interface. So here, when we go to the code inspector, we'll be having like the program name can be given, or object set can be given, or check variants can be given. So in this, like, once it's been given, we'll go ahead with this variance description, create object. So these are the various things in which we can go ahead and explore the code inspector, create and execute named inspection. So the code inspector is something which will be used for display results of named inspection. So we can see the view inspection results here. So basically, to switch on the code inspector, we have something called the transaction code SCI. Okay, we can also go to SCI transaction, write down the transaction codes, guys, sign somewhere. You have to open the transactions and just explore them. So SCI is the transaction code wherein we can check all the code inspector values. So we have create check variants, and then we have create or create object check. So we'll execute it. And the code inspector will give the program a name and execute it. So we can go for the sort criteria, sort by number of messages. We have filter conditions we can write. So we can have list of checks, like, you know, what are the issues that we have. If did we use select star, or did we use select inside a select, did we use if inside an if, all these things we can just check that. So code inspector is something we can directly go to code inspector using SCI transaction, or we can go from the ABAP and we can navigate directly. Even from SCAT also we can go to check, and in that check we'll have that code inspector option. So types of messages that we can see in the code inspector are errors that are red color, warnings yellow, and information green. These are the three things in which we have to work upon the warnings, because in normal syntax check we always ignore the warnings, but when here we also have to work upon the errors, and these errors might not be the syntax errors. Normally if you do syntactical check and we activate, these errors will not be visible, but when you go to code inspector, there are some serious issues with the performance, we can check that. Message code of subject and message of an individual object also we can check there. So this is the transaction code SCII. Okay, the transaction code for this code inspector is SCII. Okay, so here in the code inspector, what we are going to check: select statements that bypass the table buffer, select on buffer tables in a join, select on single record buffer table without explicit single star, generically buffered area not fully specified, select with subquery, select with aggregation count, okay, select distinct, select group by, select where is not null, select order by, select with specified, so client specified. These are all the different things that we have to go for the performance checks. Now these all directly go to the database instead of join, instead of going for the buffers. It will not go. See, select inner join is there, na? So inner join will not go to the buffer. It directly hits the database. So performance wise, it's not that good. So these are the various select statements which will bypass the buffer, and then it will directly go to the database. So code inspector checks analysis of where clause for select, update, and delete. Select without where clause. See, as we already discussed in many times, with select without where clause is extremely no. Okay, it's a big no. You should always give at least one select option, one parameter or something like that. In where clause, no field of a table index. So we should not have. We should make sure that even in the where clause, we have to add at least one primary field. If you observe, we were having the checks on the primary fields. VBLN was a primary field in VBAK table. So we were using the select options on that. Other than that, additionally, you can keep some more options, but this is something which we have. In where clause, no first field of a table index. So this should be avoided. Okay, these things should be avoided. So you should avoid without where clause, you should avoid where clause without the table index, and we should avoid where clause table index without the first field being taken into consideration in the where clause. So even if you want to filter the data on the country, you have to still give the primary field and then we give the country. That's a good practice. With this, the performance will be increased. So code inspector check, we need to always make sure the linear dependency the read access to the internal table is properly aligned. So sequential read access to a standard table. So if you are potential sequential read as access to a sorted table, and then hash table. So we need to see whether we have to go ahead with the standard. Most of the times, guys, 90% of the times, we'll go for standard. 9% sorted and 1% hashed. So only for read we'll be using it. Potential sequential read access to a generically typed table, and potential sequential access during deletion from a table. So these all things have to be taken into consideration for the performance. Now, what are the best practices? For the best practices, generic guidelines for efficient use of Code Inspector is use it frequently and regularly. So you either you can go to SCII transaction and open it, or you can go for the ABAP editor as well. Ensure that the object set is complete. Specify the appropriate selection criteria. Use save selections only flag. Run large inspections of background on and in parallel. Address all messages. Do not apply corrections that may impair the other statements. Do not use pseudo comments without a careful analysis. Keep in mind that the Code Inspector is a static tool. It cannot analyze dynamic coding that may lead to obvious problems at runtime. So dynamic code in the sense about if you have infinite loop, okay, so you are looping it in such a way that, you know, it is going to infinite loop. Then it's like infinite loop is something where we have A is equals to A plus B. You have loop it and then you are looping it for infinite number of times, so it should not happen. Those things cannot be accessed by Code Inspector. Code Inspector cannot detect that. Any problems coming in the runtime cannot be detected. Only in the program, the logic that we have written, we can check what are the issues using the Code Inspector, because it basically checks the code, not the runtime issues. It cannot discriminate between frequently and rarely executed codings. Now analyze the ABAP reports at design time. So design time analysis, we use the Code Inspector. But then performance analysis, when it comes, when you are executing it. So Code Inspector basically only checks your validation of the code that we have written. But performance analysis will actually go further, one step further, and it will check the processing of it. When you execute it, what happens is what we'll see. So in this, the most important transaction that we need to remember is STAD. Analyzing the components of a dialog step using STAD transaction. So analyzing the components of a dialog step, we have described the elements of dialog step time and describe the aspects of a remote function call and explain first performance rules for evaluating dialog steps. These things we'll discuss, guys. Okay, so once we give a break, and then we'll discuss about these things.